once again, we'd like to say good morning to those that are here. Appreciate you being here this morning. I'm just going to say a few things, and I'm going to sit down. I want to rest my voice, and I told the Sunday School Assembly this week, if you want to get in touch with me, text me. I'm going to try to save my voice and not do much talking this week. I know that's going to be hard, but anyway, you pray for us, if you would, please. Remember all the requests. Continue to pray for Brother Clarence. He is improving some. Pray for Brother Jack and Sister Frankie for the funeral service today for their granddaughter. Pray, Lord, to give them grace and strength and help. And then also pray for Ann Shelby. She's was in the hospital a few days. She may still be there, but she has pneumonia and she has some broken ribs. She fell in the shower the other day, so keep her in your prayers if you would. Let's stand and we'll go to the Lord in word of prayer. Remember these requests. Brother Jamie will be making some more announcements and also some more requests here in just a moment, but let's pray for the service today. It's good to have our missionary family with us this morning that we support, Brother Gary and Maria Dawson. We're glad they're with us and appreciate them being here today. You pray for them and pray for the ministry that they have. I see a lot of people fanning. I don't see nobody covered up yet. It'll happen if we turn the air on. Glad to have our visitors with us this morning. Thank you so much for coming and being a part of our service, and hope and pray that you'll enjoy the service today and the Lord will bless you real good. Brother Robert Thomas, would you pray for us, please?
Amen. If you remain standing, please turn your hymn books, page number 70. Page number 70, Rescue the Perishing. We'll sing the first and the last verse. I'm glad one day Jesus rescued me. And if he's not rescued you, you can have that safety today. Page number 70, we'll sing the first and the last verse. Standing, please. I'm glad once he rescues us, he puts us in a sheltered place, keeps us safe from the storm. Man, that's what we're going to sing this morning, Sheltered in the Arms of Jesus. You pray for the choir, Sister Norma, as we sing. Through something, you don't know how you're going to face it. I just tell you, just run to his arms this morning. They're welcoming you and waiting to keep you safe from whatever you're going through. We're going to have Brother Tim's going to sing for us this time. If he'll come around and sing for us a song the Lord's laid on his heart.
Man, I'm thankful this morning I'm sheltered in his arms.
Amen.
And the month of August is always special to us because in August of 2014 is when we started our nursing home ministry. So this time of year, always the last 2 years, we've looked back and just seen how God has blessed and how God has used someone like us. Sure, it's not always been, we've not always been on the mountaintop. These past 2 years, we've been through some valleys.
Amen.
But it's been worth every mile. Amen. Amen. It's been worth every trial. And then as this song says, we found out the longer we serve him, amen, the sweeter he grows. Amen. I don't know that I'll get through it, but we'll try. The longer I serve him,
Getting sweeter. No reason to give up now. No reason to think about throwing in the towel, stopping what you're doing. You ought to do more. You'll get more involved in the Lord's work. See, because He's already fought the battles for us. He's already done the hard part. The rest,
amen,
us serving Him, that should be the easy part. We ought to live our lives, bring honor and glory to Him, because He's already won the battles and He's placed us on the winning side.
Amen.
I was screaming every day. Have the power.
don't have to pay for my sins. Because Jesus has already done all that for us. Amen. If you'll stand, please turn your hymn books, page number 71. Page number 71. On Christ, the solid rock I stand. That's what we're going to sing. We'll sing the first, the second, and the last verse. Choir may be excused on the first verse. Page 71. My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly lean on Jesus' name. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. Darkness seems to hide his face. I rest on his unchanging grace. In every high and stormy gale, my anchor holds beneath the veil. Oh, Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. When he shall come with trumpet sound, oh, may I then in him be found. Rest in his righteousness alone, faultless to stand before. You may be seated. We're going to have Sister Toots is going to sing for us this morning. There she is.
I'm so thankful that God sent his son to save me for eternal life. And I'm so thankful for prayers, especially prayers that are answered. Things beyond my control, ready to give up the fight, weary and tired of carrying the load. I know there's no more that can do or say, and God says, just give it to me. Then I whisper a prayer that only He hears, and I rest peacefully. I can pray. Just when they will end, I know I'm supposed to be strong, but sometimes I don't think I'll ever win. And that's when he tells tells me you want without me, but in my strength alone. And when I begin to trust more in Him, I can sing a song. I can pray.
This morning. We got a lot to pray about today, by the way. Start out, we'll pray for our pastor and his throat. He's been battling this thing for a number of months, but just hadn't quite gotten over it yet. So let's remember him in our prayers. And, you know, the Bible says a prayer of a righteous man availeth much. If we just pray, we might see some of our troubles and some of our problems be availed. Amen. But we got to pray. We pray for our pastor, pray for my dad. He's having surgery tomorrow. And also pray for Brother Clarence Epley. Pray for Sister Ann Shelby. She's battling some pneumonia and some broken ribs, I believe. And pray for, remember, Sister Doris and Rick Hatchett's mother, that she'll get to go home soon, tomorrow, I believe. And then keeping your prayers today, Brother Jack and Sister Frankie, as they go through the funeral for Sister Frankie's grandchild. A lot to pray for today. And pray for our vacation Bible school that's coming up. It starts tomorrow night at 7 o'clock. Brother Bill and Sister Nancy will be with us and every week. And y'all pray for them. Now, today at 4:30, for all of the workers that signed up, at 4:30 today, we're going to have a little meeting, and we need you to be here. We need you to make sure you're here at 4:30 today if you're planning on taking part and being a helper or a worker in the Bible school this week. Brother Bill has some things that they need to share with you, so please be here at 4:30. And due to that, we'll not have choir practice today as planned. We'll push that back to next week. Now, kids, this weekend, the Bible school will be having some contests, I guess you would say, but for you. Now, every day, you'll be able to come in and purchase items and toys and candy and gum and hopefully nachos and ice cream in the store. But in addition to that, for whoever brings the most visitors, okay, now you can't count your brother as a visitor or your sister, Hayden, as a visitor. But whoever brings the most visitors through the entire week, you're going to get a special prize. It's in this box right here. Does anybody think they might know what it is? It's a box. We'll open it. Oh, tissue paper. Oh, it's a brand new tablet. Okay. Now, it's a pretty good prize. And parents, this is a brand new children's tablet that you won't have to worry about them breaking or doing stuff that they're not supposed to do on. So there are some parental safeguards there. So how many people is going to bring a visitor this week? All right. I think it'll probably take about at least 20. So y'all better get out your phones and start calling people. Not right now. Wait till after church. Tell your friends, tell your family to come to Bible school this week. And one lucky person will be able to take this tablet home on Friday. Now, as I mentioned, there'll be no choir practice today. We'll also not have any toddler church this morning. They're going to stay in today and listen to Brother Bill. And also, we have some sign-up sheets in the lobby. If you'd like to sign up to go to the trip to Pigeon Forge next week, that'll be the 15th through the 17th, if you'll sign up, of December, the 15th through the 17th. And it's $145 for both nights, which is a great deal in Pigeon Forge. So just make sure you sign up. You will have to make your own reservations, and the number's there. And there's also some information out there for the Singing at the Sea cruise that's put on by the group, the Kingsmen, the Hoppers, the Wisnets that were with us. Brian Free will be there. Their entire agency, about 10 or 12. But the information's out there. If you want to sign up for that, it's a Bahamas cruise leaving from Fort Lauderdale in February. And don't forget our tent meeting coming up. It'll be September the 11th through the 16th. Brother Barry Spears will be with us beginning of that week. And we'll start at 7 o'clock each night, including on Sunday. We'll start at 7 o'clock just to avoid the confusion. And it's not too early. We have Brother Gary here, one of our missionaries, with us this morning. And in November, we'll have our missions conference. That'll be November 13th through the 16th, Sunday through Wednesday. So make plans to be here for that. Also, the flowers here are placed by Brother Randy and Wanda Robinette this morning in honor of their anniversary. So y'all stand up. Let's wish happy anniversary. The beautiful flowers. All right, that about covers it. If we'll have the ushers come forward, please. Also, one other thing, we have some school supplies here that we'll be giving out this morning after the service. So after the service, we'll have some helpers down here, and we'll call the kids out to come get their school supplies. I think that's about everything. Brother Bill, would you lead us to prayer, please, and remember the offering. Thank you.
Brother Jamie said, in a few moments, we'll be giving out some school supplies for our children. But before we do that, we would like to recognize our teachers. So those of you who are teachers at this time, would you please stand? We have three. If you'd come down, we have something from the church that they'd like to give you. Is anybody a homeschool teacher? Here she comes. One more. Jamie, do we have one more? Let's give our teachers a round of applause. Amen. Thank you for your dedication, your hard work. And I know we pray for our children, but let's pray for our teachers, too, that they'll be a witness. I know sometimes they're limited in what they can do, but I'm thankful that a seed is planted. Amen. God will water that seed, and who knows what will come of it. Amen. So pray for our children and pray for our teachers as well.
Thank you, Brother Tim. We do appreciate your prayers, and we'll need them. We start back tomorrow here in Spartanburg, so you pray for us. And like Brother Tim said, we are going to give out school supplies, but we're going to do that at the end of the service, after the conclusion of the service. So today after the service, if y'all kids will come down, and we have the kindergarten all the way through the third grade will be over here, and Cindy and Cassie will be here to show you what you need. And then fourth grade and up will be over here, and Miss Linda and Mr. Mikey will be over here to help you. And then we have a few bags if anyone's going off to college. I don't know if we have anybody going to college, but if we do, please come down and get your school supplies. It's just, you know, it's not much, but you know, we want to help you. We want to support you in your schooling and in your education. So y'all be sure to come down and get that. All right, Brother Bill, you come on up at this time. Brother Bill Mason's been working in the children's ministry for more years than I have, but we appreciate you being with us this morning, brother.
Amen. All right, thank you. 51 years? Lord's good. Okay, boys and girls, you know what starts tomorrow night. You've already heard, and it starts at 7 o'clock, and if I were you, I'd get busy finding visitors quick. Man, you got to have a minimum of 20, is that right? Minimum 20 to win, so you better hustle. All right. But we're also going to have a prize tomorrow night for a boy or girl who attends the services here today, who brings the most guests on the Monday night. So that's different from that, but yours will be included in that, even if you bring some tomorrow night. But if you bring tomorrow night, only you guys can bring guests to tomorrow night for us. In other words, for tomorrow night, you got to be here tonight or tomorrow night, and of course you're already here. And we'll count them up and award you a prize. And don't forget, in the first half hour, Mrs. Nancy's got her story. Now, last year, she told her favorite story. This year, it's my favorite story. All right, and it's a good one. You will like it. And, of course, Miss Nancy will be telling it. And we have some strange, unusual characters are coming. Very strange this year, and you don't want to miss that. And of course, the prizes, the store, and you want to get with that. Now, adults, remember we need to have the white elephant things for the store, and you're welcome to buy them, or you're welcome to just gather up stuff from your house. You know, some of you have been collecting like that, and some of you have just so much stuff around your house, and you say, you know, it's good stuff, but what am I going to do with it? And I hope once you'll be thinking, those who have had grandsons or sons, you know, a lot of those toys, you can't, they're grown now. And a great grand's going to be a while, right? And we can use stuff for boys. Ball gloves, things like that. And boys like trucks. Yeah, you just ask a little boy about trucks and you got it right there. So bring some stuff for this week. And that'll add to the excitement of the boys and girls. And that'll be a blessing. So you come, you pray for Miss Nancy and I as we travel back and forth. And then as the meeting goes on, for God to work in hearts. And, you know, that's what happened. That's what we want, the Lord moving in the lives of these precious boys and girls. So, amen. Now, remember, 4:30, be here. And you remember, we don't pressure people to do things. It's not when you come, that doesn't mean that puts you, you have to do this or have to do that. We want you to do what God wants you to do and what you feel comfortable doing. So you come to that workers' meeting and we'll be all set for that. Amen? All right, let's turn our Bibles to 1 Peter chapter 3 and verse 15. 1 Peter chapter 3 and verse 15. We'll trust pastor will get better. May have to be turning the air conditioner off to get the pastor better. Sitting that, you know how it is, you sit underneath. That's what Miss Nancy had lost her voice in the middle of June. And we had our meeting at Tabernacle and then at Grace Baptist in Columbia, West Columbia, two large meetings, and she was struggling with her voice. But sometimes, if you ever sit in front of that air in the car, you know what I mean? And that's blowing right at your chest. It's just not very good. So obviously we're just trusting, help pastor to get with that. Amen. But the rest of us also want to stay awake. So we got to decide whether we're going to have air and stay awake or no air. And we'll all be just, I may be up here falling asleep on you. All right. Verse Peter chapter 3, verse 15. But sanctify the Lord God in your hearts and be ready always to give an answer to every man that asketh you a reason of the hope that is in you, with meekness and fear, having a good conscience, that whereas they speak evil of you as of evildoers, they may be ashamed that falsely accuse your good conversation in Christ. For it is the better, if the will of God be so, that ye suffer for well-doing than for evil-doing. Let's pray. Father, thank you now for everyone who's here, and thank you for your blessing on each life here today, even those of us going through trials, as we know this one dear family is going through. But Lord, you're good. You're good to your children through the trials. And we thank you, Lord, that you give that great joy. And I pray, Lord, that we would evidence that in our lives everywhere we go. May we not be known as downtrodden and just bad down in the mouth. I pray, Lord, that we would be always rejoicing in you. Now speak to hearts. If there be one without Christ, I pray they'd be saved this morning. And we'll thank you what you're going to do, and pray for pastor to get completely better. In Jesus' name, amen. Notice he says, having a good conscience. Paul said, I do my exercises. He said, I exercise myself to have always a conscience void of offense toward God and men. So instead of being out there pumping iron, he's working on his conscience. Say, you got a conscience? Say, yeah. And I don't like it either. It bothers me. But you know what? I'm getting tied on here. Say, it bothers me. Does everybody have one? Even those people down in these jungles? The ones that are going without, you know what? They have a conscience. Man, where'd you get your conscience? Well, God gave it to you. God gave you your conscience. But you know who's taught your conscience? Your parents. Your parents. This is why, for instance, you or I could not even think of doing what these people, these natives in these jungles. You know what I'm saying? You'd walk out like that, you'd be like this. Now, how they got a conscience. See what I'm saying? Parents train that. Now, by the way, they have certain things of shame as well. You may think, it's not like these strip joints. They have a code of ethics. And even though what you and me say, I couldn't live by that, but they have that code of ethics, and their conscience bothers them. Do you know why God gave us a conscience? So that any person you talk to will have to admit, I violate my own conscience. In other words, you talk to anybody. Hey, you always obey your mom? Well, no. Let me ask you another question. Do you always do what you know to be right? Oh, man, I don't even do what I know is right. I know it. This is my ethics. And they fail. God says, I gave you conscience in mercy. Do you know there are very serious consequences in living, violating your conscience? There really is. And my friend, you better watch it. Turn over to Psalm 32. Psalm 32. I want us to see this matter. Psalm 32 and verse 1. Page 613 in your old Schofield Bible. Blessed is he whose transgression is forgiven, whose sin is covered. Amen. Blessed is the man unto whom the Lord imputeth not iniquity, and in whose spirit there is no guile. When I kept silence, my bones waxed old through my roaring all the day long. For day and night thy hand was heavy upon me. My moisture is turned into the drought of summer. Selah. Now, what is David talking about here? He said, when I kept silence toward God, in other words, I sinned, and then instead of confessing it and making it right, which I know to do, I kept silence. I said, Lord, you really don't see that, do you? Really? My mama didn't see it. My daddy didn't see it. My grandma sure didn't see it, because if she saw it, I'd be in big trouble. But God, you didn't see it either, did you? And you know, he said, I started aching in my back. My back went out. Oh, man. Oh, my leg. Man. You say, preacher, are you trying to tell me if I'm living without confessing my sins, that's why I got back trouble? I don't know. Is it? Is it? Say, really? You know, living with a guilty conscience has consequences. And some of them are physical. Some of them are physical. Let me give you some illustrations of people who've had the way they found out if they had a guilty party. The Indians had one of my favorites. They had a thing. If they had a brave that had done something wrong and he brought him to the council, did you do it? No. What they did is they got a fire going. Indians like having fires, you know. And then after they got the fire going good and hot, they put a knife in there. And they got it red hot and white hot. And then they brought the Indian up again and said, did you do it? No. Stick out your tongue. This is true, by the way. Stick out your tongue. And they would yank that white hot knife out of that fire, and they would touch it for a split second to his tongue. Say, what in the world? Look at that last verse there. My moisture is turned into the draught of summer. What's in your mouth when you tell the truth? Saliva. That's why some people don't like sitting in the front row of the church, because you get a shower. Ting, ting, ting. Pastor shooting at you with the saliva, right? What happens when you lie? Your mouth just dries up. Well, if that old Indian was innocent, when you touch that, it goes, psst. He's innocent. What if he's guilty? When they peel him out of the trees, woo, they got him. He's guilty. There are physical consequences. People live with headaches and things like that. And I'm not trying to tell you that this is why you have what you have. I'm saying that this goes with guilt. It goes with guilt. But you know, there's another one. Remember the lie detector test? Remember that? They took you in there and they asked you some questions, and they questions that are, you know, the easy to say. How old are you? Well, I'm 16. You're lying. and all that, because there's changes in your physical makeup when you lie. And that little machine did it. You know what they found, though? That it tended to be a little too sensitive. There was a story. They used to have an old radio program called the Lie Detector Test, taped from long ago. And I remember this. I haven't forgotten this one. There was a church crime committed. And I forget what the crime was, but the interesting part of it was when they brought in the lie detector test, the treasurer of the church got selected. And when they began questioning him, he had a good alibi. He really hadn't done what they were looking for. But they were trying to figure out why he failed the lie detector test. And the more they questioned him, he was putting his hand in the offering plates. He said, you know what? He said, I'm not getting paid anything for this job. And so he said, I'm taking it. See, when you violate anything, it throws the whole thing off because you'll appear guilty no matter what you did because you have been doing wrong. He was stealing. It was against his conscience and he knew it. But you want to know the Bible one that's fascinating? You remember the woman that had been accused of adultery by her husband? God said, bring her to the priest at the tabernacle. They brought her to the priest. You committed adultery on your husband? No, I have not. Said, go into the temple, tabernacle, and scrape, this is true, you read in your Bible, Numbers. You scrape some dirt off the floor of the tabernacle in a glass. Now, what do you think would be in the dirt on the floor of the tabernacle? Dried blood from the sacrifices, right? And then fill it with water, hand it to her, drink this. Yeah. Hey, priest said, don't worry. If you're innocent, nothing will happen to you. But well, I'm warning you, if you're guilty, your belly and thigh will rot. Oh! And she had to drink that stuff. Wow. Have you ever known a time when so much of what we eat could cause us trouble? Every time you read a new article, coffee is bad for you. What did they say? My wife was telling me that. Coffee causes cancer. Isn't that what they said? Yeah. But is there anything ever that we could eat that is totally... You know what I think part of the problem is? It's the guilt that we live with. The guilt that we live with. And if there's anything in that food you're eating that's questionable in the least, that guilt can trigger things in your body. My friend, if you decide to live apart from your conscience and you violate it again and again and again, you are going to find yourself living with medical problems. I remember a doctor. He's still a doctor on Woodruff Road in Greenville. And I was in his Sunday school class years ago. And somebody said to him, how many of your patients would you say are... probably not really sick, they've just, you know, sin sick, and they've, but there's actual medical. I've forgotten the number. It was over 80%. 80% of his patients, a medical doctor, were sick because he said they could change the whole thing if they changed their lifestyle and did what they're supposed to and didn't live against their conscience. Wow. But you remember, there's also emotional consequences. Remember King Saul? King Saul was one of the nicest guys you'd find. I mean, seriously, when they offered him the job, he went and hid. He hid. He didn't want to show out. He didn't want to do that. But once he got the job, he did like a lot of us do. You know, we get the position now. And Saul, it went to his head. And all of a sudden, he went out of his head. Remember that? He's sitting there. Because he was violating his conscience. What he had been taught to do as a young man in a Jewish family. And he was a Jewish patriot. He wasn't a very spiritual man. But he was a Jewish patriot. But he violated all these things. And what he did, as many presidents and congressmen do when they get power. And it went and it began to just throw him off. And you remember the cure? They brought David. And David began to sing a little rock music for him. You think? He didn't want to send him really into the trees. David sang the Psalms. And as he sang, the Lord is good, a stronghold in the day of trouble. God will forgive You know what happened with Saul? I'm all right. Lord, I'll do right. And he got okay. Till the next opportunity to do wrong came. And then he went out of his mind. And he really went. Listen, my friend, you want to have strong emotions? What does the Bible say? God has not given us the spirit of fear, but of power and of love and sound mind. Did you know fear and the sound mind are exact opposites? I mean, if you're, and that God told the Israelites that. He said, if you do wrong, a thousand of you will be chased by one of them. He said, God can do that, can't he? He can make you hear things. Remember how the enemy ran from Israel? Because they heard. We heard noise. We heard this. What is that? That's fear. And my friend, listen, when you decide to live apart from what God has taught you, what your parents have taught you, my friend, fear is the result. And that fear will not allow you to have a sound mind. You know, they're one of the type of counseling today. I forget, is it nouthetic counseling? It's where they take the Bible and counsel. Jay Adams was one of the great proponents of this, and Bill Gothard for these things. And you know what they found? That when they went to the mental hospitals, they found amazing cures. They just simply started talking about getting right with God and confessing the sin and getting their lives right with their families. And all of a sudden, people who are like that just suddenly were okay. My friend, you can't live violating your conscience. But then there's spiritual consequences. I think of Lot in Sodom. Boy, I'll tell you what, Lot was a believer, wasn't he? You think you'd have known that if you didn't read the New Testament where it said, just Lot vexed with his righteous soul from day to day. You wouldn't have thought it, would you? When you read what happened with his daughters, when you read how everybody turned and all that kind of thing. And the listen, he went into the gay lifestyle and became important in it. Remember that? He sat in the gate. You know what that meant? He was a Supreme Court justice. How would you like to be a Supreme Court justice today dealing with all this bathroom change nonsense and all this change and the gays and what we're going to do with them? And that's what Lot was doing, vexing his righteous soul from day to day. And you know, Abraham sure tried to save Sodom and Gomorrah. If, Lord, if there's 50 righteous there, Lord, how about 45? How about 10? There weren't 10 people that Lot had led to Christ. He had sat there. His conscience was violating. How do you witness when you're doing wrong? How do you witness? How do you soul win? When you go to a church that is wrong. Brother Thomas and I were talking. Today you got more and more Baptists going to Catholic churches. And a lot of cases it's because they get married to somebody. They'll marry a Catholic and then they've grown up Baptist, whether Southern or whether independent or whatever. But suddenly they're sliding over and they say, hey, church, one church, good another. Oh, yeah. Your conscience is going to eat you alive, my friend. You know better. My friend, if you know Jesus Christ, that is not Christianity. And my friend, you are not going to be comfortable in Jehovah's Witnesses. There's the book, 30 Years a Watchtower Slave? And this man was a believer going into it. And when he came out, he said, you know what? I realized that it was wrong. You can't. And my friend, this affects your witnessing. What will it do to your family? What's it going to do when you are violating what you know is right spiritually? Can you be on top? Can you sit there with your family and say, children, this Bible is true when you're not obeying it? What are you going to do? You're going to pay the price of losing your children. You're going to pay the price that no one's going to pay attention to your testimony, even though you know the Lord. And one day when you stand before the Lord and you don't have anybody with you, children, grandchildren, nobody listened to you. what a terrible thing is going to be at the judgment seat of Christ. Do you know there are people go to a good church like this one, and because you're doing what you know is wrong, not in here, but out there, you're having a hard time making good friends. And I don't know whether you've ever had this experience. I have had it. I couldn't prove it, but I've had people shake their hands with me like this. Hello, brother. They're like this.
Good brother.
Pastor knows that. They walk up. Hey, Pastor. You know what? When you're not doing right, you can't. You can't make the friends. Because your conscience says they're listening. They know everything about you. Don't let them be seeing you. Just avoid them. And boy, do you ever miss something. The sweetest thing this side of heaven is Christian godly friends. People that love God will pray for you, and you miss it. And you go home and you say, I don't like it at the church because it's not friendly. You know what's not friendly? That's not friendly. Isn't that a terrible thing? But what is the answer to it? Well, I think the primary answer to it is if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Did you know that means naming your sins to God? Do you know what I thought after I got saved? I'm a Yankee boy. Pennsylvania, and I wasn't Catholic, but I mean, anyhow, after I got saved, I thought if I just said every night before I go to bed, dear Jesus, if I sin today, I'm sorry. No. Confession, think of the legal term, confession. If a guy got in court and the prosecutor said, Mr. Jones, we want a confession. We know you did this. I'd like to confess that I was a bad boy on June 26th. Mr. Mason, Mr. Jones, we want a confession. What did you do on January 26th? I robbed the bank over there. Zartenberg, I did it. Thank you for your confession, right? I didn't confess the first time. All I was doing was mealy-mouthing, trying to get around a confession. But a confession means I tell God what I did. I've thought it through. It's wrong. And what do I intend? Not to keep doing it, right? Whoso confesseth and forsaketh shall have mercy. It's not like the Catholics do. I went to school with about, 75% Catholics. Really, I mean, everybody was, and they were nice. Some of them were nice people, but they really were not spiritual people. I only knew one boy that his family was pretty faithful to the Catholic Church. I mean, they really were, and the boy was a very nice boy. I don't believe he was saved. I believe he ever knew the Lord, but he was nice. But the rest of them, they just went to the confession, did all that kind of thing, lived like they pleased, and they did not do that. And, you know, that's sad, isn't it? But you need to confess to God and make it right and cease. But do you know there's more to it than that? Jesus said, and when ye pray, what's the next word he used, at least in one of the forgive? Didn't he? He said, if you will not forgive, what? He won't forgive you. Does that mean you lose your salvation? No. He's not talking about salvation here. He's talking about daily confession of sins. If you are going to be unwilling to forgive, then you, my friend, cannot be right with God on a daily basis. I'm serious. You may even go through the ritual. Lord, I lied to my mother. Please forgive me. He isn't going to. Why? Because you know Mary over there? And I'm not pointing to anybody. You know Mary over there? She asked you to forgive her and you wouldn't, would you? Well, I'm not forgiving you. That means what happens? The guilt. The guilt. I had a lady one time years ago. This lady, we knew her because her child came to our Bible club and she said, could I bring my child, talk to Mrs. Nancy? My child's having real problems, really going, and all that kind of thing. Bring her along. So we came in there, and she said, we got sitting down in my office, and my wife was there and all that. And the lady looked at her girl and said, run out and play with Mr. Bill and Miss Nancy's children. I thought, wait a minute, she's here to help her get right. No, she was there because of her. When she was younger, an uncle had abused her physically. And but suddenly it came out. And you could see the dark cloud come over her face. She hated that man. Can you understand? She hated that man. She hadn't seen him in some time, but she hated him for what he had done to her. And that was carrying to her child. And all we could say was, I know you can't absolve him of what he did. No one can do that but God. But I said, you can forgive him and give him to Jesus. Say, Lord, it's over. I'll not hate anymore. I can't do it. Can't do it. And finally, she said, I will. And she bowed her knees and she walked out happy. A couple of weeks later, she said, you know, Mr. Mason, my daughter's cured. We never talked to her daughter. My friend, you cannot not forgive. And some of you have been going for a long time, unwilling to forgive a person, a parent. Maybe you were mad because you thought your father, your mother liked your brother, sister better than you, did more for them, and be honest with you, maybe they did. Let's be fair. Parents aren't perfect. All you have to do is read about Jacob and Esau. You'll find out about imperfect parents. But that doesn't mean that you don't forgive. Because, my friend, God makes a specific warning. But maybe, my friend, maybe you have been the wronger. You've done the person doing the wrong. And what does it say? Therefore, when thou bringest thy gift to the altar, and there rememberest that thy brother hath aught against thee, leave thy gift before the altar, go thy way, first be reconciled to thy brother, and then come offer thy gift. God isn't interested in all your sacrifices. And I'm not picking on any singers today, please. God isn't interested in how you sing. God isn't interested in how you teach. He's interested that you are living everything you can right between God and man. You say, how do you do that, preacher? Well, my friend, you're going to have to go to somebody. And you're going to have to admit you did wrong. Well, I'll tell them they did wrong and I did wrong. No, my friend, if you're going to get right, then you got to admit the whole thing. You say, well, it wasn't all my fault. It made a difference. If they were coming, they could admit the whole thing. But since you're coming and you say, well, I can't do it. All right, go ahead and live with your guilt. See what that's going to get you. Lord, I'll do anything to have the guilt gone. All right, you ready? You make the appointment. I'm here to tell you how sorry I am for what I did to you. Would you forgive me? I was wrong. Asking you to forgive me. You say, what if they won't? Well, that's up to them. Now you put the guilt over to them. They want to continue to live that way. They can do whatever they want. But you can be out guilt-free. Wow. Isn't that what God wants? Is that what you want? Your life changed. Now, maybe there's somebody here not saved. And I'll tell you what. I don't care how you've tried to fix those things. That guilt will stay with you at least until Jesus saves you. And you've got to let him. Now, thankfully, he'll save you in a moment, won't he? Whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Lord, I'm lost and I've messed it up. I messed up my conscience, my life, my parents. But God, would you save me? Yeah, and by the way, you don't have to go to all these people first. God will forgive you first. Then he'll help you to go to those people. And he'll ease, because some of you need a lot of easing when you go to some of these people, because they're mad, boy. I mean, imagine, see, some of you have been fighters, and you've been popped some people out, knocked some teeth out, and you've done some other things. You say, whoa, but you let Jesus save you. And he'll change you, and boy, when you walk in the new person with the tender spirit, wait and see what God. Because he does it all, doesn't he? If you're not saved, come to him. Let's bow our heads in prayer. Heavenly Father, I thank you for your word. And I thank you, Lord, for what you have done for us. And I pray, Father, for every soul here this morning. If there's someone here without Christ, I pray that they'd be saved. If there's someone here been suffering with the matter of unforgiveness or done wrong, I pray that this will be fixed this morning. We commit it to you, Lord. Heads are bowed, eyes are closed. Is there someone this morning say, preacher, I know I'm not saved. Maybe you've even prayed to be saved. But you say, I know it wasn't real either, preacher, because there's been no change in my life. I know there's no difference in me. That old me is still the old me, and I need Jesus. Would you pray for me? Just slip your hand up. I wouldn't call you out or embarrass you, but if you'd like, you say, I'm not sure I'm saved, pray for me quickly, up and then down. Anyone at all? I see a hand there. God bless you, a young person. Anyone else? Between you, me, and the Lord right now. Anyone else? I wonder if there's somebody say, preacher, there's somebody that I need to forgive. Somebody I need to forgive for Jesus' sake. Like Jesus forgave me. And I've been unwilling to forgive them. And I like prayer. I've got to do something about this. I by the grace of God, I'm going to do it. Pray for me. Slip your hand up. God bless you. Amen. Amen. Anyone else? Say, preacher, somebody I've not been willing to forgive. Could be a parent. Could be a neighbor, sister, brother. Anyone else? Anyone else? Hands all over. Anyone at all? I wonder this morning if there's somebody say, preacher, there's somebody I have greatly offended. I know because they won't talk to me. And they used to. When I come, they turn around. They won't even look at me. I know that I've broken it. I know what I did, too. Pray for me, preacher. I don't know how I'm going to do it, but by the grace of God, I want to do it and get it right. Pray for me. Slip your hand up. Anyone? I hurt. God bless you. Amen. May put it down. Thank you. Anyone else? Anyone else? Preacher, there's someone I've wronged, and may not be a great deal of thing, but you know it's affected them. Anyone at all? Anyone else? Anyone else? Between you and the Lord and me right now. Amen. Let's stand, shall we? Prayer, shall we? Everyone standing. In a minute, we're going to have our song. I can hear the song that I like to hear, just as I am, without one plea. But let's pray first. Heavenly Father, I'm, Lord, committing these hands to you, Lord. I pray, Lord, for victory in their lives. I pray that this one who's been not forgiven, I pray that she'd get that, Lord, taken care of and have peace with you. And I pray for this one that, Lord, has somebody to go to. Would you give them her grace? And I pray that the other one have the willingness to forgive, and it'd be a wonderful time. But Lord, whatever, that you give peace about this matter and this soul. And if there's others that didn't raise their hand and yet there's a need, Lord, I pray they'd come. Lord, you can help them, I pray. And Lord, if there's somebody still not saved, I pray they would be. In Jesus' name, amen. What number are we going to sing, brother? What number? 375. If you come, pastor will be meeting you here if you'd like to pray. But if you just want to come pray at the altar, you want to sit down and pray there, you do
just
it.
As I am with
Heads are bowed, eyes are closed, piano instrument's going to play just a little bit. Someone ought to come. We're about to let our brother close the service. But if there's someone ought to come, you come right now. If you want to, like I said, if you want to sit down and pray, if you want to go out and to find another room in private, you go. But if God's dealing with your heart, I invite you to come. Anyone quickly now before we turn it over to be closed. Amen. 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 Anyone else ought to come between you and the Lord? Say, preacher, there's things that got to be fixed. It's got to be fixed. I can't live this way. I can't live with this conscience eating me alive. Just when I see that person, it just gets to me, Mr. Bill. It gets to me. How can I live? Well, fix it with the Lord. And He'll help you fix it with them. Anyone else? Praise the Lord. Anyone else? God's working in hearts. And if you're not saved and would like that, be sure to see Pastor first. Be sure to say, Pastor, help me. Keep playing now. Keep playing. Instrument's going to keep playing. If you are uncomfortable standing, you feel free to sit down for just a few minutes. It won't be long, we'll close. But if you're uncomfortable standing, you feel free. Just sit down and relax a little bit and pray for those who come.
Just a minute. We've done what we said we'd do. We've prayed for you this morning. Those of you that raised your hands, you may have still have something on your heart, something on your conscience that you need to confess today. The next step's yours. Come this morning and leave it at the altar. Turn it over to Him and He'll take it away from you. Maybe there's something in your heart or in your life you need to pray about. Maybe there's someone you need to pray for. Once you give it to God, you'll feel a lot better. Wait for just a moment. Preached, he said, we tell God we'll do everything, anything. Plead with Him. We'll do anything. Whatever you say, Lord. confession's a good place to start. Forgiveness, prayer, seeking the Lord. Appreciate you being with us this morning. Brother Bill, Sister Nancy, we appreciate the message, brother. We need to heed our conscience. We hope you'll be back with us tonight. Don't forget, at 4:30, all the Bible school workers, if you've signed up to help, please be here at 4:30 for some very important information to help you through this upcoming week and to get you pointed in the right direction. Then at 6 o'clock, we'll have our evening worship service. For the children, the school kids, don't forget your supplies. Miss Linda and Cindy and Cassie and Brother Mikey will be down here to help you with those. I hope you've had I hope you got what you need this morning from the Lord. I hope you've felt His presence. He's been here. I hope you've got what you need. Brother Dennis, would you dismiss us, please? And